for me. It goes without saying that the story of a God who decides to nisa, put a father through a test to see if the, in some way the father is worthy and the father loves God enough. You understand, there was no God who ever did that. And in some way it bothers us, because the whole, even if it didn't happen, why does it have to be written then this way? And it's almost as if, why couldn't the story have gone something like this? There was a man named Abraham who had a son named Isaac. And in his time, people sacrificed their firstborn to in some way appease or manipulate the gods. And the people came to Abraham and said, it's time. You must sacrifice your firstborn son. And in our Torah, Abraham would say, no, I will not do it. And so they kidnap Isaac. And they take him to Moriah. And they bind Abraham and make him watch. And they take Isaac to the hill, and they're about to slaughter Isaac for the gods while the father must watch. And at the last moment, God cries out from heaven, don't stretch forth your hand or touch the child. Abraham is right. And everybody goes, whoa. And the son is spared, and Abraham and Isaac go back together. Somehow, wouldn't that be just a lovely story? But it wouldn't be the same story. There really would be no power to that story, and no message to that story. In its time, the message was that people who really had a relationship with what they believed was a divine, they thought this was the right thing to do. And even Abraham thought it was the right thing to do. It is so interesting to read the text, because the narrator, whoever is the voice of the Torah, which is an interesting question in and of itself, whose voice are we hearing in this Torah? The voice of the Torah says, God decides to test Abraham, and God says to Abraham, Avraham, Avraham. He answers, Hineni. Great, great word. Here I am. He says, take now thy son, thine only son, whom you lovest, even Isaac, to a hill that I will show you. And what does Abraham say? Does anyone remember what Abraham says? He says, not a syllable. Nothing. Instead, he gets up in the morning, gets his stuff together. Isaac is ready, puts him on a horse, donkey, whatever, takes his lads with him, and off they march for 3 days. During those 3 days, what does Abraham say? Nothing. And is there a sense of criticism of Abraham by the narrator? Does the Torah suggest some form of displeasure, critique of Abraham? And remember, this is the same Abraham who only the day before, God says to Abraham, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham gets huffy and puffy. You can't destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. There might be 50 righteous people in the city. Will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Is that what a righteous God does? And then we know there's a story. The next thing you know, it's 50, 40, 45, 40, 50, 45, 40, 30, 20, 10. And it is one of the magnificent moments of Abraham, where he argues that God cannot destroy this way. It's a chapter later. And he's told to take his son, and he doesn't utter a word, and the text is not critical of him. Why isn't the text critical? Because in its time, this was what righteous people thought they should do. There is a wonderful passage from the prophet Micah. And we just read from the prophet Micah, that paragraph that comes before we take the Torah from the ark, that ends, "Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither they shall they learn war anymore. Everyone shall sit under vine and fig tree. None shall make them afraid." That's Micah. And there's a passage from Micah in Sedra Balak, where Micah says to the people, "What is it that God wants of you? What will make God happy? Does God want..." He lists all kind of ritual things, and then he ends. In the text, Micah says, "Does he want the fruit of your firstborn child?" "No," says Micah. "What God wants is only that you do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with thy God." That iconic line, "Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with thy God," follows Micah's question. Does God want child sacrifice? Why does Micah have to ask the question? Because that's what was done. At that time, in biblical times, it was done. They lived, you know, sometimes we forget. If Abraham walked into this room, he would be so scary looking. And he wouldn't know any of our conventions. And these are people who lived before the world began, practically. Do you ever say to yourself, how lucky we are to live now? Maybe, you know, our children will say they're even luckier to live when they live, but we're so lucky to live now with indoor plumbing and electricity. You know, we had an outage of electricity. Well, it was like the world ended. I want to die. It was like Jonah. I want the gourd back. How can I live without electricity? And there was a time when the world of medicine today, it's just like a miracle. And these big, heavy, multi-thousand ton things fly, which I don't understand. And these people lived in a very frightening world, and their idea of God was that there was a power somewhere in the universe that took care of everything. But you had to make sure you kept on the good side of that God. And one of the things you did was give your first fruits. You were lucky enough to have a good crop. Well, you knew that if you wanted a good crop next year, you took the best of it and you brought it to Aaron's family in the temple to keep God happy. And then there was the ultimate. You were blessed with children. The first child was sacrificed to God. When Abraham feels that call, there's nothing about it that's strange to him. And so he doesn't say to God, "Are you out of your mind?" He just goes. And there is that wonderful, wonderful line. And you should look at it with me. Take your books. In English, it starts, "And Isaac spoke unto Abraham." Do you see it? In Hebrew, "Vayomer Yitzchak el Avraham, Aviv, his father. And Isaac spoke unto Abraham, his father. Vayomer, and he, meaning Isaac, said, Avi, my father. Vayomer, and he said, meaning Abraham, Hineni b'ni, here I am, my son. Vayomer Yitzchak, and Isaac said, El Avraham Aviv, to Abraham his father. Vayomer, he said, Avi, did I skip a line? Did the same line twice? Okay, yeah. So he says, Vayomer, Hineni ha'esh, he says, behold, the fire, v'ha'aitzim, and the wood, v'ayeh ha'aseh le'olah, but where's the ram, where's the lamb for the offering, le'olah? Remember, by the way, Isaac here is 37 years old. This idea that it's a child is not the case. 37 years old, which changes the whole view of the story. But it doesn't matter for this purpose. And he says, Hine ha'esh, v'ha'itzim, v'ha'yeh'aseh le'olah. You know, I see the fire in the wood, but where is the ram for the offering? Vayomer Avraham. Now watch this line, Hebrew and English. If you know any Hebrew, it's so fabulous. Vayomer Avraham. And Abraham says, Elohim Yirelo Haseh. Look at the English. And Abraham said, do you see what it says in English? God will provide the lamb. Where's the lamb? Where's the ram? Where's the offering? God will provide. Do you see the Hebrew? Here's what the Hebrew says. Elohim yirelo haseh. Ra'ah is the verb in Hebrew to see. What the actual text says is, God will see to it. By the way, there's the Lamed. Those of you who were there last night, we talked about L'chaim, that when the Jew says to life, it isn't our wish for life, it's wish for people to L'chaim, to be part of a process, a journey of life. That Lamed is so important. And here again it comes up where it says, God will see lo, to it, for it. And then it says, Bini, my son. So there's a very classic midrash, and we're not doing midrash tonight right now, we're doing text. But I don't want to forget it, so I'll just show it to you. You know already that in the midrash, Abraham is seen as the real hero of the story, and in the end he will challenge God. What he does not do in the text, Abraham does do in the Jewish tradition. In the end he says to God, you want me to stop the sacrifice? I won't stop the sacrifice till you apologize, admit you were wrong, and make a promise to me for all eternity, so that when we hear Ken Asher blow the shofar, you'll hear it too, and you'll forgive us. The rabbis, however, read the passage to be. We read it, it seems to read, and Abraham says, God will provide the lamb, my son. In the Midrash, they put a semicolon after God will provide. And Abraham says, God will provide, or it's my son. There is enormous debate as to whether this suggests that Abraham knew all along that there would be a ram provided by God at the end of the story. But it's not text. In the text, Abraham is just going forward. And in the end, it is Abraham who binds Isaac and is about to slaughter Isaac. And in the text, forget Midrash, in the text, what happens? an emissary of God, a malach, calls out from heaven. Oh, we're looking at it together. It's so great. This short chapter, so powerful. Vayikra elav malach Adonai min hashamayim. And an angel calls out, the angel of Adonai calls out from heaven. Vayomer Avraham, Avraham. He says, Abraham, Abraham. And he answers, Vayomer hineni. The same word he begins with, he ends with, here am I. Vayomer, meaning the angel says, Al tishlach yadcha el hana'ar. Do not stretch forth your hand to the child, to your son, to the young man. By the way, it goes on, Va'al ta'as lo mu'uma, in the midrash, there is a semicolon, because there's one classic midrash in which Abraham hears the angel say, do not stretch forth your hand against the son, as if the sacrifice is not to happen. And Abraham is so caught up in spiritual ecstasy about to fulfill this enormous ritual of sacrificing one's own firstborn child to this God somewhere in heaven. And he has worked himself up into it to such a fervor and a frenzy that when the angel calls from heaven, Abraham says, if I don't go through with this, this will have been for nothing. You mean I came here for nothing? Can't I at least take a little bit of blood? Can't I just make a scratch? To which the angel, that's not in here, but the text, that's the midrash, to explain the next line. Because it says, Vayomer al tishlach yadcha, don't stretch forth your hand, el hana'ar. And then it says, Va'al ta'as lo mi'uma, do not make a mark on that child. And the rabbi said, why do we need both? Because in the reality, the angel says, don't do it. And Abraham says, oh, I got to do a little bit. Don't even put a mark on that child. Don't put a mum in that child. And the power of this story for the people of its time was that it was not a human being who said, this is wrong. This is so important for us to understand. It was not a human being who says child sacrifice is wrong. In our Torah, it is God in heaven who says, this is wrong. You will not do it. You will never need to do it again. There's a ram, go take the ram. If it were a story about human beings, it would be interesting. And we did have that when Abraham fights for Sodom and Gomorrah. But here is a bigger message. It had to be God who made him do it so that God could stop it. And in the end of the story, Abraham and Isaac are both saved. And when Abraham, it's like if there was a newscast that night, it would be, God says, don't do it. God says it's not necessary anymore. Which makes this passage, this chapter, in some way, the most life-affirming chapter in the entire Torah. It is Abraham receiving l'chaim, and then the Jewish people receiving l'chaim, and the Jewish people teaching l'chaim. All from this story, which has to begin the way it begins. And that's the story in its time. And the story moves as we move. And so we know that the rabbis are as upset with the story as we are. And so they create this marvelous midrash, which does another layer of greatness to this story. This becomes, to the rabbis, the beginning of moral sensibility. The journey of L'chaim starts with the Akedah. When again, in the Midrash, Abraham says to God, how dare you even ask? That when God sends the angel to stop the sacrifice, Abraham says to God, Abraham says to the angel, if God wants me to stop this, you tell God to get here, God's self. And in the Midrash, God comes. And you have the sense that God is so sorry that he had made this horrible mistake. And I ask you, do you know of any, well, it doesn't even matter. Do you understand how amazing it is that a Jewish tradition creates both a text and a story, a midrash, in which God says, I'm sorry? And if there's anything for us to learn, it's to learn from the model of the God that's a character in a morality play. But that our tradition ascribes to this God the ability to say, I was wrong, and I've learned from you, human being, Adam, what is right and what moral sensibility is. And we've talked about the fact that the Torah is meant to be a mirror. If I gave you a mirror, and if I gave you a photograph of Adam, and you looked at it, Adam would look just like me. Meaning, every one of us should say me. I give you a photograph of Adam. You look at it. It looks just like me. Whoever looks at it. I give you a picture of Eve. Who does it look like? Me. I give you a picture of Abraham. Who does it look like? Me. I give you a picture of Isaac. Who does it look like? Me. That is the Torah. And this is not, by the way, this is not Golub. The Jewish tradition calls the Torah a mirror. We are to see ourselves in every story. And if that's true, what's the mirror asking us? The mirror has a different message. The message of the text is, there's no God in heaven who wants you to sacrifice your firstborn child. The message of the Midrash is, you will have moral sensibility, that you will criticize, you will have the courage to speak truth to power, whatever the power is, including heaven. And that if you're not to sacrifice, you're not to sacrifice your children in any way. You may not ask sacrifices of other people. They are people with their own dignity and their own journey and their own hopes and their own dreams. And your job is to lechayim them. Not to judge them and not to sacrifice them. What you ask of your children may not be a sacrifice. What you ask of your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife, your friends, you may not ask sacrifice. You just bring blessing. Bring blessing. Help them l'chaim. Be with them. That was the message of last night. Just be with people you love. And give them and share their l'chaim. You lift a glass and say l'chaim because you promise. That l'chaim is a promise that you will do everything you can not to enslave, but to free. And I talked last night about, you know, how it's so important, the Jewish tradition says, to let children become who they are. And how important it is to spend time with children. No time spent with a child is ever wasted. No amount of time spent with a child is ever wasted. But the truth is, no time spent by a child with an older parent is ever wasted. No time spent with a grandparent is ever wasted. No time spent with a family member, with a friend, is ever wasted. It's l'chaim for them. And the Midrash takes this Akedah, flips it on its head, and says, yes, human beings will judge right and wrong, even if it comes from heaven, because the Torah is not in heaven. It is out our mouths and our heart, and we will do it. And so it's not enough to say, don't sacrifice your children. Don't sacrifice your wife or your husband or your best friend. Don't ask of them unfair things. Just do things for them that enable them to, in some way, fulfill their journey to life, to L'chaim. And when we read the Akedah today, it is my hope that in some way, those are the ideas that you hear in the text, that you appreciate what it was for its time, and you appreciate the message it has for us today, that we will bring our own moral sensibilities to every issue facing us, that we will not ask sacrifices of people in an unfair way, we will only bring blessing to them, and we will exalt in one of the most fabulous, simple, short chapters ever written by civilization. And it all comes from Sedra, Vayera in the book of Genesis, which the rabbis ask us to read so that we can begin a new year on the path to L'chaim. And we all say, Amen.